In a previous video, we looked already at how to generate number sequences, lists of numbers, and then interpret those numbers as pictures, and therefore that we create music. But the algorithms we used for that were relatively straightforward. Now, in this video, we are looking at an algorithm that is a classic of algorithmic composition that has been used since the late 50s. So algorithmic composition is almost as old as computer science, and this algorithm has been around for quite some time in this field. In a nutshell, what a Markov chain does is analyze a given sequence and see which element follows which, and how if you have a sequence, which element follows which, and how likely it is that a certain element follows another. I'm not going actually into the algorithmic details. For those interested, there are loads of details on that out there online, but I'm looking here into how to use that within PWGL in a very straightforward way by using some existing library that implements all that already. This is a library called FLAT that has been developed by Urgent Sundred. And yeah, we looked at this website before in the video on how to install PWGL. Yeah, I'm just briefly showing the URL again. Sundreds.com downloads. So we use that library, and now we are going to PWGL. In PWGL, you want to load that library, and that's called FLAT. Yeah, just to be absolutely sure, I'm showing that briefly again. Yeah, I did already load that because I'm using a patch here. And to speed matters up, I briefly set up this patch already just to show where you find that. If the library is loaded under Studio FLAT Tools, Probabilities, and then the objects we use here are Markov Analysis and Markov Sig. So Markov Analysis, this guy takes some sequence, analyzes which element follows which and how likely it is that it follows, and then out of that analysis, this box generates a new sequence that has a similar characteristic. And just to demonstrate first how this works, I'm showing a very simple sequence, which by on purpose is not necessarily musically interesting. It just shows how this algorithm works. So we have a number sequence here. If you just listen to these numbers, MIDI pitch number, so that's middle C, 60, and then D, and so on. Yeah, that's our sequence. And we can see that 60 is followed by 62, or if you read notes, C is followed by D, either or alternatively, C is followed by C sharp. D is followed either by C, or D is followed by D sharp, and so on. And with that kind of information, the algorithm then can generate a new sequence. So we generate a new sequence here now of 10 elements. I just press V, and then I have, you see, a sequence that by random starts with this C sharp and then does the list exactly as we have before. Yeah, C sharp, D, D sharp, and so on, until it hits the E, C, and then it jumps back, and it so happens that it seems to start at the beginning. But if you do this again, yeah, so I'm just playing this. If I re-evaluate this, then randomly it starts somewhere else. And yeah, just to, here's an example where you can see after C, it goes to D. But then it only goes to D up again and goes back. So there is no context. It always looks at two neighbors always. Now, musically, as I said, this is not necessarily very interesting. This was just to demonstrate how this actually works. Now, I'm replacing this input by another input that has some musical interest already. That's the beginning of some chorale melody. I'm just playing that. And so on and so on. Yeah, you get the idea. If I want to get the pitch sequence, yeah, I entered this by hand in this editor here. How do we get the pitches? In this object, you can see there are several outputs. And one of them is called pitches. Go away. And if I select that and press evaluate to see the output, then you can see that gets me some rather nested list. I'm not discussing now in detail why this is so much nested. That has to do with the fact that the score can represent multiple parts, and within a part you can have multiple voices, and then you have multiple bars and so on, and that's represented with this nesting. We are only interested in a flat list, so I take this nested list and apply the list function flat, and then we have a flat list. You can see at the bottom of the window here, yeah, instead of me going here, yeah, that also shows here. I'm just showing that again. And now I take, yeah, so I'm just showing it here, flat list. And now I'm taking that list and input that into my original Markov analysis box. I'm slightly reordering these boxes because the patch, like as it is right now, is hard to read, and I just want to show you some good practice to make patches a bit more easy to read. Yeah, you either write them from top to bottom or from left to right. Otherwise it gets easily confusing. Yeah, so we go top to bottom and then to the right and then go downwards again. Okay, now we should have something which is somehow similar to this melody. Yeah, remember again. Yeah, the rhythmic values and hence the tempo is not preserved. This is a bit too simplistic. We can make it a bit more similar to what we actually input by not looking only at direct neighbors. Yeah, currently it looks at direct neighbors, very little context. We can tell it to always take two elements into account and then look at what follows after that. That's a so-called Markov chain of second order. And this box conveniently implements that we can have second order. So I just change that. And if I re-evaluate it now, then it is a bit more similar to the original melody. Yeah, you perhaps can confirm that if I take another example. Okay, it can be rather repetitive, in particular if there is a repetition in the melody. Oops, sorry, I just had some example where we had this. Yeah, so you get the idea. Basically, what we have here is a simple machine learning algorithm that takes some existing musical material, a plain sequence, only the pitches, or alternatively, we could also take only the rhythmic values or some other values, but yeah, not any more complex representation, just some flat sequence, and analyze that and then create something similar. Musically, this can be, because you can just go on generating lots of material, this can be a useful way to generate results. OK, Okay, so by chance it now created something which is very similar to the original melody. It's basically the same. Yes, now as a second step, a third step, yeah, if, I'm now taking another patch that I prepared before, which just make everything a bit bigger here. Do that. Well, I'm introducing some more elements. First of all, this is exactly what we had before. I have here a switch box that's new. I can switch between different alternative imports, basically between parts of patches. Yeah, Markov analysis we had before, Markov sequence. This I'll explain a little bit later. But yeah, so this is basically the first input we had before. Yeah, you will remember that. If you want to create such a switch in your own patches, that can be found under control, and there's a switch. And then we have this box. It only has two buttons here. If you want to have more buttons, we can expand the box by pressing plus, or on my keyboard, I need to press shift and then the equal sign, which is plus. And you see it gets larger. Or alternatively, I make it smaller and just press minus. I could also use the number block and have the pad number block plus and minus. Yeah, just to show the way. And I also put a color here just to briefly show if you, oops, sorry, you can control click a box. Yeah, I control click, you need to control click a certain corner. And there are a number of things you can do, including change its color. Okay. Now, I want to introduce, yeah, we had the choral melody here. I want to introduce some new way. And that is, if this is a machine learning algorithm that can take some musical input, why not take the input of some existing music that I don't need to enter by hand as I did here, but instead that I load from a MIDI file. That sounds a bit more flexible than to generate some input or to swap different inputs in there. So I select this box that's MF2Score. I think I showed this before. That is under Utilities, MIDI, MF2Score. I evaluate the box, and now I just have the normal macOS file dialog where I can select, and I take this MIDI file here, I saw three ships. I open this. Now, for convenience, I just evaluated this MIDI file input box because what I want to do now is tell it, remember, please, this setting so that I don't have to load it again and again. Yeah, alternatively, I could evaluate something down here and then I have to give it the MIDI file again and again. Instead, I do the same control click on the box name here again. And you see there is something called toggle lock on and off. If I click this, then a little key shows up here. If I evaluate the same box now, then the menu doesn't show up. Instead, it remembers what I loaded before and keeps that. There's also a shortcut for that. If you have this box selected and I press L for lock L, then it's unlocked and locked. Okay, now I evaluate my score editor just to load the MIDI score into the score editor. So it's as simple as that. And there I have this MIDI file. And so on and so on. You see there are a number of paths which are currently hardly used. I'm interested in using the top melody, only the top part, and want to extract that. Now, we use the pitches here already and simply flatten that. But because we have multiple parts here, that doesn't work. I first need to take the first part. So what I do is I take these pitches without flattening them. Remember, that looks rather busy. In this case, it looks even more busy. Yeah, very nested, only pitches. And I use the box here, Posen Match, which takes the first element in that list. So we have a list, something highly nested, and we take the first element, which is another list. Yeah, if I look at this again, I look at this nested list, you see, very long list. That's the whole list, and I want to only select the first sublist. Yeah, something like this. And that's what Posen Match does. And just to make understood the project. Yeah, so that was the first element, the pitches of the first melody. And now I flat that. And within that list, if I'm looking closely, there are some elements, like this one, that are a bit special. It says nil. Nil is an empty list. An empty list are two parentheses just opening and closing. That's there, I guess, because there has been a rest, didn't have a pitch. So it can't have a pitch there. And so therefore, I take everything out that I don't need here. There's another box. Remove from this flat list. I remove everything which is nil. Yeah, here I wrote this with open and closed parentheses. I could also write nil. This language takes it as the same. And now I have, you see, this last nil. Yeah, the nil we had there at the end of the previous list is now gone. And this I can directly use now as an input for my Markov analysis. I switch my switch box to take this input now. There's another, yeah, I'll explain that in a minute. And now I evaluate this and I have some melody. Yeah, you can see this was already also Markov chain second order. Yeah, somehow similar to the melody we had. The longer the melody is, and if there is some pattern within the melody, the more easily the algorithm, the Markov chain, can pick up something and generate something which is related but not quite the same and yeah, has some interest. Yeah, that's a tendency in general with machine learning. If you give it more data, that usually helps. Interesting what it does harmonically, yeah, that was a bit surprising. Okay, now why is this remove there? Just to demonstrate that theoretically, sometimes you have a case where you have some element that has no follower element. Yeah, in this sequence we have 60. Yeah, I'll just open this. That has been a text box. Remember, text box you find under data, text box. We could also use a value box, but text box can be more convenient to enter larger amounts of text. You see, in this sequence we have 60, 61, 62, and so on up to 64. If the algorithm ever reaches 64, then it doesn't know what should follow, because it's not specified in the sequence anything that follows that. So if I set this to this, and want to generate four elements, yeah, I'm just removing everything here. I let the sequence generate four elements, then you see it generates the sequence, but then at some stage, it reaches 64 and then it tells me, sorry, I don't know how to go on. And it signals that by giving me nil. But the score editor doesn't know what to do with that nil, and therefore I remove that. So if you have some MIDI input and that somewhere ends at a node that hasn't been there before, that could result in a dead end and therefore an error. And so that's why this is there. Okay, to briefly summarize, the Markov chain is an algorithm that analyzes a given sequence, looks at what follows what, and that can be used for music composition. And we can use that by either, we can actually entering the Markov chain data by hand if you want to. That can be laborious, but that's very flexible. Or we can use this as an algorithm that gets some musical information, and then this musical information we can compose by hand. Or we take some existing musical material, like some MIDI file, and run our analysis on that, and then generate music with that input. We could generate music that is similar to the input we gave it.